So that is a wrap on The Last Dance. Wow, what a terrific ending to what was an incredible 10-part series. Like, I'm still, like, sad that it ended, because I was hoping that, you know, I mean, this went by fast. Like, these past 5 weeks went by really fast, and honestly, I'm just hoping that, you know, I'm just can't wait to for all this stuff to be put online, like on Netflix and stuff, because I know I'm gonna watch this over and over again, go back and watch a bunch of stuff, because I know that I missed a lot of important stuff, so I'm gonna go back and watch it. Plus, it was just entertaining in general, so can't go wrong with that. But let's just start with talking about episode 9. What did they started off with the Reggie Miller stuff, about how, like, Reggie Miller thought that he could take down the Bulls and end the Bulls dynasty. They started with the Eastern Conference Finals battle in 98, how they went back and forth, and then in game 4, Reggie hit the game winner, which, I mean, it looked like a push off, but we're gonna leave it at that. And then how, you know, how intense that battle was, with two great players and Reggie Miller talking about how he thought he was going to win and calling Jordan a black cat, which made no sense. I didn't understand what that meant, but it was just interesting to watch how the both of them, I don't know, like, went back and forth in that way. And they talked about how, like, they showed the fight too. That was like 92, 93, which was, I mean, you can't go wrong with watching a fight and watching Reggie Miller get punched in the face, but it was still fun to watch. I mean, I didn't mind that battle. I think it was a nice short thing to talk about. Then they went back to 97 to talk about how in that finals, I mean, it was the Bulls and the Jazz, obviously, but they asked Jordan what was, like, his biggest motivating factor in that series. And for him, it was the fact that Karl Malone won the MVP that year, which, I mean, yeah, that's interesting, because obviously, look, Jordan's gonna feel like he deserved to win MVP every single year. That's just how he feels. But, you know, you hear those theories that, like, oh, they wanted to change it because they wanted it got too boring. You know, they gave it to Charles Barkley one time and they gave it to Karl Malone one time just to make things interesting, which, I mean, you could argue. And again, LeBron fans are going to say they do the same thing now. Otherwise, LeBron would be MVP every single year. But, look, I don't know. I think it's dumb. I don't know. I don't really care about that conspiracy all that much. But, I don't know. It just doesn't make any sense to me. But Brian Russell, man, Brian Russell. Imagine him watching this right now. Like, imagine him watching this documentary. Like, the way that Jordan had him on a hit list. Let's be very clear. That was a hit list almost. Jordan had, like, a list of people who talked stuff about him in the past or challenged him or said anything, even, like, the smallest, like, thing. Jordan took it personal, and he said he did. He said that he made everything personal, which is fascinating with the kind of competitor he was. But in that context, Brian Russell was that guy who was on the hit list. So that was interesting to watch, because they talked about how Brian Russell talked a lot of smack when Jordan was still playing baseball. And then Jordan basically from that moment on was like, oh, okay, I'm going to come and bust your ass now, which is fascinating. They talked about in that final series in 97, they talked about the flu game. And it's interesting how they talked about it. They basically, it was all started from a pizza. Like, Jordan was hungry one night, everything was closed. So then they somehow got him a pizza in Utah, and then he ended up getting food poisoning, and then everything happened where he got sick. Okay, this was probably the most interesting part of these two last, like, episodes, because only because, like, that story itself is interesting, but then also how NBA Twitter, I mean, it's Twitter, but how they not spun it, but, like, how they made it a meme. Like, they made the meme of, like, okay, who are these five guys? Like, how are five guys delivering pizza for one guy? How did that call the delivery? How did that order go through? Hi, I'm calling Pete for one order of pizza. Oh, for what's the name? Oh, Michael Jordan. Like, imagine, like, in Utah, by the way. So, obviously, the theory is, did the Utah Jazz or did people in Utah give Jordan a funky pizza that made him sick? I mean, you can't rule it out now. Now that you hear it, you know, now that we hear the story in depth and everything, you start to think, maybe they did. Maybe they tried to sabotage him. They tried to sabotage Jordan and get him sick and whatever, but I mean, obviously, we know what happened in the game. It didn't work, you know. They tried to poison him with a pizza, but he ended up poisoning Utah, the Jazz, in that game anyway. He scored 38 and 44, which is ridiculous for, like, think about, like, someone doing that now. Like, when you think about that game now, it just seems irresponsible, especially with, like, everything going on right now. Like, imagine someone, like, imagine a player playing right now who had the virus, you know, had the Rona. Like, imagine some player, like, imagine the NBA comes back, like, whenever it's safe and stuff, and someone's like, oh yeah, I have the Rona, and they still play. Like, imagine how that, like, that reaction is completely different from the way that we reacted to Jordan, or how I imagine people reacted to Jordan at the time when he played, when he was still sick. I don't know, it's just, like, wild to me. It's just interesting how they talked about it in that way. But I do think, I like how they touched on it, though. It was interesting. They talked about Steve Kerr, which was, honestly, when that started, like, talking about, like, Steve Kerr, I didn't understand why they did that. I'm like, okay, why did they have to do a whole segment on, like, his past and his, like, history and stuff? Because I didn't know any of that stuff. I just thought that, okay, you know, he was not really the most, like, sought-after player, but then he came into the NBA, he knew his role, and he did his thing. He became, like, you know, a really, really good shooter. But then you hear, like, his story and, like, what happened with his father. I mean, oh god, like, that's just tragic stuff. You know, he went through a lot of hardship, and that's a side of Steve Kerr that I've never seen before, and I imagine that a lot of other people who watch this documentary haven't seen before. So I like how they let that happen. I like how they let Steve Kerr, whoever, you know, ran this stuff, I love how they let Steve Kerr, basically, they gave him a platform to basically talk about that situation. I don't know, I feel like it gives people a different look into him as a person and his life and stuff. So I love how they did that. You know, it was confusing at first, but then the way that they put it all together, I think, was really nice. I really liked that part. They talked about, obviously, the iconic shot in Game 6 that Kerr had, you know. Okay, if they double, you know, him telling Jordan, if they draw the double, I'm going to be open. I mean, it happened. They drew the double, and then Steve Kerr came out near the free throw line, and he made the shot, and they won the chip. So I guess it worked, but I don't know. It's cool to see him have that confidence before the shot. Like, he just, like, knew, like, okay, Jordan's going to get double teamed because they're going to give it to him. Everyone expects it to go to him, but they're not going to expect Steve Kerr, of all people, to hit the shot. So for him to be ready like that, I mean, you have to be when you're in that situation, I guess. So it was cool to see that. I mean, it's so crazy because Steve Kerr, to this day, I didn't know this, but I had to check, he still has the highest three-point percentage, like, higher, like, the highest ever, which is interesting. You know, everyone knows how great of a shooter he is, and then you see the team he coaches and who's on that team, but it's still, like, Steve Kerr appreciation. You can't go wrong with it. They talked a little bit about Gus, the security guard, which I don't know, like, that story about, like, how him being there for Jordan, you know, when his dad died, and how Jordan had that, you know, that person there for him, and then when Gus got sick, how Jordan was there for him too. So, like, I don't know, I feel like that's the side of Jordan that we don't see, or that we don't hear about as much. So to get that insight is, I think, good, because it gives people a different perspective on the person rather than just the player. I think that giving that perspective is a good thing, because it gives people, especially young people like me, who only know Jordan as a great basketball player, we don't know the person as much. So for us to see that, I think it's a good thing, because it gives us a new point of view, I guess. They talked about that game 7. So they talked about all that, and then they went back to that Pacers Bulls rivalry in the conference finals, and then they talked about that iconic game 7 and how, you know, the Pacers were up for a little bit with a little left in the game, you know, the Pacers got a little cocky. They thought that, okay, we're going to take down the Bulls. The dynasty's over. We're going to the chip. And then the Bulls, you know, Jordan came back and Pippen got on a roll and everything came back. And then what happened? They won. So I think that was interesting to watch. And then after that game, they showed Jordan go to Larry Bird for the most iconic part of these two episodes. And possibly he gave us the greatest meme of all 10 episodes. You know which one I'm talking about. Jordan and Bird are walking in the tunnel. They see each other, and then Jordan says, I can't repeat it. I'm not going to repeat it, but I'll put a picture up right here. You know what I mean. He said this, and when that I heard that, I already knew. Like, I knew right away, right when he said, I'm like, this is the one. This is the one. This is the meme. This is the one. Everyone's going to see it, and then long that I knew, it became a GIF. The picture went everywhere, and now everyone's using it for replies, which, I mean, man. Like, the show, like, not only is this documentary great, like, it shows us that not only was the documentary great, but it gave us such iconic memes that we are going to use for a long time. So, you can't go wrong with that. So, that's basically episode 9. For episode 10, I don't have much to talk, you know. I think it was cool that they had Jordan's three kids in the beginning talking about how much they hated Utah, which you can't go wrong with. I mean, in Indiana, they showed that, like, crazy white lady screaming. I don't know what that was, but it was a Karen moment. And then they showed Utah. Like, every B-roll you saw of the Jazz fans was... They all had the same complexion. That's all I'm going to say. So, I mean, you could imagine how Jordan's kids felt or how people in general would feel about Utah at that time. You know, when you see that crowd, you think of the people in the crowd. You're like, wow, this is a very white crowd. I mean... You know, I don't want to bring it up, but I mean, look, you saw the B-roll. It was true. The iconic finals game one was interesting. Game two was interesting. And then Dennis Rodman. We thought that one episode they did on him, you know, I thought that was wild, but this is something else. After game three, the Bulls do a blowout, but then Rodman skips practice. That didn't surprise me as much, but I was curious, what was he doing instead? He went to join the NWO with Hulk Hogan. I mean, like, what? Like, that's just wild to me. Like, even me saying that, it's like, really? He did that? Which, I mean, now that you think about it, it doesn't sound as crazy because it's Dennis Rodman, but like, really? Really? Like, the NWO with Hulk Hogan, he skipped practice for that. Wild, man. Like, imagine someone doing that today. Imagine an NBA player doing that today. I can't even, like, picture that. And, you know, everyone thinks, oh, is there any NBA player right now that has, like, a fraction of Dennis Rodman in them? No. Like, you can't think of any NBA player right now. They have nothing compared to, like, Dennis Rodman. He was his own character, and he was his own person, and he was wild. I'll leave it at that. It was hilarious. Karl Malone slander. Ooh. I mean, NBA Twitter. I love it. All my homies hate Karl Malone, right? I mean, just... I love some good old Karl Malone slander. He's a garbage human being. We'll get that out of the way. We'll move on from that. Scott Burrell. I don't know how to pronounce his name. Scott Burrell. Man, Jordan just had, like... Man, Jordan, like, rent-free, man. Scott Burrell, like, had something. Jordan, like, hated him. Like, genuinely hated him, kind of. Like, the way they talked, like, to each other, and then... Well, not really talked to each other. It was... Jordan was the one who was saying the most stuff. Oh, I'll whip your ass. Like, okay, really? Like, it's just funny, because it's like... They give the guy a break, man. Jordan just didn't give the guy a break. He was on him for that whole year. That practice, during the games, after the games. He was a bully. Jordan was a bully, and it was so funny because it's like the man can't catch a break. You'll have to see it. They talked about, obviously, that basically the 10th episode was obviously dedicated to that entire final series, which makes sense because it was the last one. So obviously they go to game 6, which was the last one. Scottie Pippen has the back pain. He's going in and out of the game, going back and forth from the locker room to, you know, the court. And, you know, it's weird to see how he deals with that, and basically what that does is it leaves Jordan hanging. He's gonna have to do all the work by himself, which he usually does, but at that time, in that such a pivotal moment, you know, the game six where they can basically end it, you know, and for to have Pippen going back and forth between the locker room, that's tough with a back injury too, which is, you know, that's difficult. So that's a huge obstacle. And then they talked about, obviously, the last like 40 seconds of the game, which is probably, they said it in the documentary, and I think I agree, the most iconic 40 seconds in sports history. Like, the Bulls go for a 2-for-1. Jordan gets a tough layup, gets it in over by Brian Russell. They go back on the court, and then the Jazz run a very predictable offense. They give the ball to Malone in the post. He doesn't see Jordan on the weak side, so Jordan's easily able to strip the ball from him. They go back, and then Jordan hits the iconic shot. Everyone, again, continues to argue, was he pushing off? I don't care. It was not a push-off. That's the end of the discussion. I hate the whole, was it a push-off, was it not? It wasn't. Let's move on. But yeah, that iconic shot, like that, man, that shot is like iconic, right? It's like one of the most iconic pictures in sports history. Like, you think of the posters and the images, right? Like, it's my wallpaper right now on my desktop, because it's just one of those moments, you know? It's like an art. Like, that shot is almost an art form in itself. The way that it happened, the way that it was like presented, even in the documentary, it's just crazy. So the last shot happens, the Bulls win, that's the end of it. They win the sixth championship, they celebrate in Chicago and everything. Man, like, I can't imagine being in Chicago at that time. Like, I always think about it, like, you know, because this was before I was born, so I couldn't imagine what it was like to be there in Chicago during basically that decade when the Bulls were basically on top. I can't imagine what it would have been like, you know. I always think about it, but man, it's just great to see. They show all the celebrating, and then at the end we get classic MJ with the iPad, which you love. I'm gonna miss watching MJ react to stuff on an iPad. They need to do more of that. Like, they just need to like do another 10 episodes where like he just like, ooh, you know what'd be funny? He just reacts to tweets on NBA Twitter. Like, imagine MJ on an iPad reading tweets from NBA Twitter. Oh my god, imagine that. Ooh. Ooh, the world needs to see that. And then they basically talk about how the Bulls break up, and we finally figure out who did it. It was Jerry Reinsdorf. Okay, now for all these years, all the speculation, all the conspiracy, it was Jerry Reinsdorf who broke the team up. Now we know, and now all my homies hate Jerry Reinsdorf, all right? Man, that's everything in my notes. Man, this was such an incredible documentary, and I'm so sad that it's done now. But again, like I said, I can't wait to watch this again and again and again, because it's just so good. The past 5 weeks were great because it gave us something to look forward to while everything's going on right now, because obviously there's no sports right now. So now that this is done, what's there to look forward to, you know? We have to continue to wait for sports to come back. So it sucks, but you know, I think that I'm really gonna love the past 5 weeks. They were great, and I'm so glad that they did this documentary. They did it so well. Everything about it was great. The storytelling, the editing, the soundtrack, the people they had in it, everything about it was just terrific. So, you know, Jordan said that the documentary would make him look bad. Honestly, it made him look even better. So that's basically. Is that it? Yeah, that's it. That's basically everything from my notes. So I'm going to wrap it up. Thank you guys for watching all of the reviews. I love doing these because it was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun with this. You know the rest. If you haven't already, leave a like, leave a comment, what you think of the episodes, what you think of The Last Dance in general. Subscribe if you haven't already. Turn on notifications to know when I upload. And yeah, that's basically it. I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.